My message this morning is a question. Have you seen the Lord Jesus? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, the entry into your word gives life. We ask that you give us life. Pray that you open our eyes, that we may see wondrous things. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
A few years ago, a man was working against the will of God, and he thought that he was doing the right things. He thought he was making it in the right way, because you will not believe it, this person is a pastor of a church. And he thought that he was leading the church right and everything was going on. He felt that the right way that people should follow is the one that he was doing. But he was kicking against the gospel. He was doing things against the people, the children of God. At that time, God raised some young people. Those young people were gathering together to worship God. They were praying, they were having Bible study, you know, gathering together, and they were spreading the good news to other people. And this pastor was against them. They were in the church just like this. And the children, the young people, they loved to gather and study the word of God and to, you know, do the will of God. But this pastor maintained that they should never gather together again. That only when they come to church on Sunday, as he will be leading them in the worship services, that was what they needed. They needed not to gather together to pray and to do anything by themselves. So he thought that they would not be able to do anything that would be right. So he got some elders behind him, and together with him, they sent these young people out of the church. So those young people were accepted in the residence of one of their fathers, the father of one of the members. So that place, the residence, was made for them to be having their programs. They would be worshiping them. And come and see these young people. They were multiplying. They were getting more people. The man bought benches for them, so they could sit down at the outside the house. They would sit down, see many people, and more people were coming. And when the members of the church, when they saw it, about for some months that they've been sent out, they were multiplying. And this is really something that they needed in the church. So they said, let's call these people in. Unfortunately, that pastor had left at the time when they called them back to the church. So one day, they were having a program. And that program was a great convention that they used to have. So the man, the pastor, happened to go to that convention that time. And the pastor was really touched by the Spirit of God, and he came to them and he apologized for what he had been doing. He said he knew that what they were doing was right in the presence of God, that he did not know before, that all these things that they have done have been the right things, that he apologized to them. He said that, really love to continue with the kind of things that they were doing, and he would be attending their fellowship and all that they were doing. So this pastor will come over and will be fellowshipping with these people. When we look at this thing and we watch what happened in the life of Saul, Saul was a Pharisee. And he came from the land of Israel, a genuine Pharisee. And so at the younger age, he started to persecute the church of God. And he started to do all those things. And one will still think that this man, Paul, should not be doing this because he was following Torah, he was following the law. But the point is that he did not understand what he was doing. He thought he was doing it right. In our epistle today, Paul was very zealous and he thought he was doing the right thing, just like that pastor. He thought he was following the right course of the law. So that was what led him to be following the kind of life of persecuting the church of Christ. And if we look at Acts chapter 9, looking at verses 1 and 2, meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. That was the work of Saul at the time. He was persecuting the church. He was persecuting the disciples of Jesus Christ. He did not want anything like that, just to follow Torah, just to follow the law of Moses. And that was all. And this law of Moses, they were not really following the right way, because they were just do the work of do's, don'ts, and all that kind of things, but they really didn't allow the Spirit of God to permeate through their lives. And the question is, have you seen the Lord Jesus? If anyone has never seen Jesus, that person will not be able to do anything. So his name was Saul at the time when he was persecuting the church and before his conversion. He has been persecuting the church from his early days. And that was at the time when he even had his hand in the death of Stephen. Stephen, one of the staunch member, staunch disciples of Jesus Christ. And looking at Acts chapter 7, verses 58 and 59, then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats and at the feet of a young man named Saul. That's the Saul we are talking about. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And looking at chapter 8, verse 1, and Saul approved of their killing him. He approved. He loved it that they killed him. That day, a severe persecution began against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout the countryside of Judea and Samaria. So they were all scattered. They scattered all abroad because of that great persecution and all the efforts that Saul was doing. And devout men buried Stephen and made loud lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church by entering house after house, dragging off both men and women. He committed them to prison. That was what he was doing. He was committing them to prison. He was giving sanctions that they should be killed. Now those who were scattered went from place to place proclaiming the word of God. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah to them. So they were preaching all about, they scattered all abroad because of persecution. And that is what is happening even to today. The church of God is under persecution. Persecution. People are no longer, when they talk of religion, they carry all sorts of religion. But when it comes to Christianity, it's few people, because it's a road that is less traveled. Not many people understand And they do not know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And that's what Jesus says himself. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. It's through Jesus Christ that you can get to the Father. And that is it. But Paul was just persecuting the disciples, was doing all evil against them, together with all those Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Sanhedrin. They all gathered together to kick against all the spreading of the gospel. And Paul had these things to say about himself later on. Looking at Philippians chapter 3, verse 6, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. You know, he thought himself to be blameless under the law, even though there is no one that can be so clean by following the law. He thought he was blameless. He said, as pertaining to the law, I was blameless. And Acts chapter 22, looking at it from verse 4, I persecuted the way up to the point of death by binding both men and women and putting them in prison. As the high priest and the whole council of elders can testify about me. From them, I also received letters to the brothers in Damascus, and I went there in order to bind those who were there and to bring them back to Jerusalem for punishment. That was what Saul was doing. He was persecuting the church. He was destroying the church. You will not be surprised if you see people doing things against Christians, doing things against those who want to stand for God. The Bible has even said that those who want to stand for God will face persecution. So they begin to persecute all those who are believers, all those who want to obey the voice of God, who want to obey the scripture, who want to follow the right course. They will face and they will say, oh, that is too much. That is too much. We must do it quietly, gently, and all these things. So persecution comes when you stand for God. And looking further, in verse 26, indeed, I myself was convinced that I ought to do many things against the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And that is what I did in Jerusalem with authority received from the chief priests. I not only locked up many of the saints in prison, but I also cast my vote against them when they were being condemned to death. By punishing them often in all the synagogues, I tried to force them to blaspheme. And since I was so furiously enraged at them, I pursued them even to foreign cities. With this in mind, I was traveling to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests. So that was when he was caught. He was going to Damascus to do the same. He got the letters, he got the authority, and he proposed from Jerusalem, I'm going to Damascus. I'm going to confuse those followers of Jesus. I'm going to discomfute all their efforts and make them to be miserable. So he was so furious, and he went, he was on his way. And the question is, have you seen the Lord Jesus? Saul had an encounter with Jesus on the way to Damascus, and his life was no more the same. His life never remained the same when he got in contact with the Lord Jesus Christ. We can see this from Acts chapter 9. Now, in verse 3, now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? He asked, who are you, Lord? You know, the Spirit of God is at work at this time. If not, how did he know it was the Lord? He said, who are you, Lord? The reply came, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. When you are persecuting a believer, a child of God, when you are persecuting somebody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are persecuting Jesus. And that's why Jesus is saying, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do. At this point, he had become blind because some specks have entered into his eyes and he could not see anymore. He fell down and he had the voice of Jesus Christ, and at a place it says that it's a serious thing for you to kick against the God. And so Jesus Christ met him. When Jesus meets you at a point, you will have no other choice. When Jesus touches your life, you will never remain the same. And so the question is, have you met Jesus? Have you seen the Lord Jesus? When the Lord touches your life, I know you will surrender all. As terrible as Saul was, as strong in persecution as Saul was moving, when Jesus touched him, he remained the same no more. Jesus touched Saul, the persecutor of the disciples of Jesus Christ, and he became Paul. He became Paul. And not just Paul, he became Paul the apostle, a great apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. So when God touched Abraham, it was Abraham. When God touched Abraham, he became Abraham. Abraham was the idol worshiper. He was worshiping the idol of his fathers. And that was when he was at the land of Chaldea. He was worshiping his father's idol. But when God called him and turned him to Abraham, he became the father of many nations and the father of faith. So when God touched Sarai, at the time she was Sarai, she was barren, advanced in age, she was miserable, without a child, and they called her the barren, Sarai the barren. But when God touched her, she became Sarah, the mother of many nations. The mother of many nations. When God touched Jacob, the supplanter, Jacob who supplanted his brother, Jacob who supplanted his father, Jacob who supplanted his father-in-law, the same Jacob, when God touched him, he became Israel. Israel means the Prince of God. He became the Prince of God. God touched his life and God made him a new person. I want to let you know, when God touches you, you will remain the same no more. You remember when God touched Moses? Moses was a stammerer. Moses was a murderer. You know, he killed an Egyptian because of an Israelite. And for that matter, he was a stammerer. He could not put two words together without saying mama, mama. And this is Moses. God touched and he became the deliverer of the Israelites from the bondage of Egypt. When God touches your life, you remain the same no more. So when God touched Jabez, you know Jabez in 1 Chronicles chapter 4 verse 9, and 10, you know, when God touched Jabez, Jabez was a sorrowful person because his mother gave birth to him in sorrow. So he was called the son of sorrow. And Jabez prayed. He prayed earnestly to God that if you can turn around my life. And God answered him, and God made him to be more honorable than his brothers. He became more honorable than his brothers. There is no one, no person that the Lord will touch and that person will still remain the same. The Lord is touching people. The Lord is rewriting the history of people. God can rewrite your history. God can renew your life. God can rejuvenate you. God can make you to come back to a new life. And that is what we are seeing. Have you seen the Lord Jesus? Have you seen the Lord Jesus? Since the Lord Jesus Christ resurrected, he has been appearing to people in one way or another. He has been, you know, physically, people saw him when he rose up in those days. The disciples saw him face to face. And today, he's been showing himself in different ways to people. And I know if you have not seen the Lord Jesus Christ, then today might be your opportunity. I'm persuaded that the Lord is appearing in a way people will understand, that the people will know. If the Lord touches you, you remain the same no more. In John chapter 21, we are told in verse 1, after these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. What brought them to this way is that after Jesus died, Peter rose up and said, I'm going out fishing. And six older disciples said, I will go with you, I will go with you, I will go with you. And the six of them followed Peter and they went to the seas. They started, rolling in the seas. What does that mean? It means that Peter backslid. He turned back. When he saw that Jesus Christ had died, he said, what else? And the Lord we are following has gone. What else are we going to do? So he left the work of the ministry. He left the work of evangelization of the world that Jesus committed into their hands, and he went into his former job. He was formerly a fisherman, and now he went back to his work. Let's see further in verse 4. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to hold it in because there were so many fish. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. In verse 12, Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. So you will see Jesus appeared to them. But let me tell you a bit about it. When Jesus appeared to them at the Sea of Tiberias, the disciples were rolling the sheep in the water, trying to get fish, but they could not get any, nothing. And that was when Jesus said, put it this way, and they caught fish, and they could not even draw the sheep because it was full of fish. And now, Peter did not know that it was Jesus. Even none of them knew at the first time. They didn't know. So they were doing the work and doing the work. And Peter was naked. He was in stark nakedness. I want to beg you, when he was doing all this, he did not know that it was Jesus. And he was moving out of water into the water and, trying the best he could to get fish. He couldn't get any. So he was so much absorbed in the work he was doing. But he did not know that it was Jesus standing. And when John, the beloved, when John realized it was the Lord, he told Peter that it's the Lord. When Peter heard that, he quickly jumped into the water. Because of what? Because he was naked. So he was somehow embarrassed that, the Lord has seen me, naked me. So he went into the water. And I presume he dressed up and he came back. And now that was what informed Jesus to, ask him questions. Now, when Jesus reveals himself to you, he will assign you a job. And God wanted to assign them a job and wanted to give Peter a great job. But the way Peter did made Jesus to ask questions. To ask Peter question whether he would be able to do the work that he was giving him. And let's see in John chapter 21, verses 15 through 17. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than this?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." You know, that was a simple question and that was a simple answer. But Jesus did not stop there. He asked the second time. The second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." So he said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." The reason you would have already known the reason why Jesus is saying this, he knows everything about everybody. And he knew when Peter was naked. He knew when Peter decided to go back, to draw back. Many people are backsliding. Even appearing in the church for many is just for to see my face. Many are backsliding. They are not really following the truth anymore. And that is why we don't take things for granted. If you are among such people, it's for you to decide, redecide, renew your strength, and come back into the Lord. Don't just take it for granted that, what's appearing in the church. It's more than just appearing in the church. We need to put everything into the label that Christ has given us. We need to surrender ourselves completely and be obedient to the scriptures. It's not just a joke. It's a thing of eternal life. It's a thing of life forever. And we need to make our decision suddenly and never allow anything to deceive us. And at the end, we will say, "Oh, had I known." Had I known should not be our God, because he has opened to us the truth. We have known the truth. When should we turn back then? Peter turned back. And Jesus is now reinforcing unto him and was reiterating the question, "Do you love me?" And the same thing for you. Do you love Christ? Do you love Christ? "Yes, I love my God." Do you love Christ? "Yes, I love my God." Do you love Christ? Hallelujah, we shall come to see the Lord. Hallelujah, when he comes to take us home. Hallelujah, we shall come to see the Lord. Hallelujah, when he comes to take us home. Do you love Christ? Have you seen the Lord Jesus? Have you seen him? This is the time we need to correct our ways. You know, to work together befits us. It's not a matter of going to heaven. Each individual, we have to face the dance. We have to face one by one. It's my friend that deceived me. It's my father, it's my brother that didn't allow me to do this. It's not terrible. You have to find yourself out. And I pray God will help us through in the name of Jesus.
Amen.